Okay, sementara kita tunggu azan Isyak ni habis, cuba tengok dulu dekat the first question on the first slide. Eh? First question on the first slide. Okey, baik. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh dan selamat malam. Kita ada hari ini kita ada Alia, Halis, Najwa, Atira, Nisa, Rahil, Rosham Haikal dengan Sarah Kamal. Okey, kita ada ahli baru malam ni. Jadi sedikit pengenalan lah. Selamat datang to the first class of biology online class. Setiap kali kita ada kelas, saya akan dalam at least 10 minutes before, saya akan cuba bagi at least 10 minutes before dua link. Satu link untuk Google Meet, satu lagi ialah link untuk PADEC. So PADEC ni is basically Google Slide atau slide PowerPoint biasa saja, tapi pada slide tersebut bila kamu access, kamu ada ability to respond to various questions provided in the slide. Kamu boleh jawab, nanti kamu akan tengok ada part yang kamu kena lukis, sebab bio ni ada lukis, ada diagram dan sebagainya kan. So ada part yang kamu kena lukis, ada soalan yang kamu kena jawab, macam yang ada dekat Google Meet sekarang ni, yang saya tengah pamerkan sekarang ni ialah satu jenis aktiviti yang kamu kena type. So kalau kamu tengok pada student view, I think this is your, sekejap ya. I think this is your view. Okay, I think this is your view. So kamu just click pada answer here tu dan boleh start menaik lah. Boleh jawab di sini. Okay, jawab di sini. So boleh guna text saja. Lepas tu, kalau kita, nanti kita akan tengok ada soalan-soalan lain yang kena draw dan sebagainya. So nanti saya akan tunjukkan macam mana nak buat lah. So at the end of our class, saya akan release nota ini dan nota ini automatically akan dihantar ke dalam email kamu ya. So at least you have a copy of each of our classes notes for you to refer lepas ni. Okay, and then apa lagi ya? Satu lagi, dan satu lagi ialah jawapan yang saya pamerkan ni ialah jawapan yang saya tengah tunjuk dalam Google Meet ni adalah jawapan semua orang. Okay, jawapan semua orang. So bila saya present, every answer tu tak ada nama dekat bawah ni. But on my dashboard, under each bubble ni, saya tahu siapa yang tulis jawapan ni. Okay, so I will respond to your answers accordingly. Katakanlah macam kalau jawapan kamu tu banyak kena tweak, banyak kena update, jadi saya akan bagi personal feedback. Saya akan type dalam bentuk apa, bertulis lah. Saya akan private message dalam padat. Nanti kamu akan nampak lah. Kamu dapat feedback daripada saya. Kalau misconception tu adalah misconception umum, semua orang pun, majority of you have the same misconception, ada salah faham sikit, so saya akan cakap secara umum lah kat sini. Alright. So, last Monday, we have started to do a revision on factors influencing enzyme. We know that kejap. Sebelum tu, Rosham Haikal ni memang DLP juga kan? Semua DLP kan? Boleh jawab dekat message dalam Google Meet atau boleh jawab dekat Padlet? Okay. Okay, good. Okay, saya boleh continue lah. Semua orang pun DLP. Alright. So kalau ada yang non-DLP, saya punya notes akan jadi dui bahasa. Tak ada masalah ya. Alright, so let's take a look at your answer. Let's take a look at the question. So last Monday, kita mula discuss about factors influencing the rate of enzyme reaction. Kita discuss soalan faktor temperature. Now, for this particular question, we are going to discuss about the effects of pH towards enzyme reaction. Tapi kan ini gambar apple je. Mana datangnya enzyme tu? So when we cut apples atau orange ke, after quite some time, the part that is exposed to the air will become brown. Bila kita potong buah apple atau buah pear ke, kita dapati sebahagian daripada permukaan yang terdedah pada udara tu akan jadi brown. Why? Because the existence atau the detection of oxygen, the presence of oxygen on the surface of the apple ke pear ke will is an indication for an enzyme inside the cells of apple fruit ke pear fruit ke to start digesting several molecules in the apple atau in pear. So when the enzyme started to break down molecules on the surface of the exposed apple, the molecules are brown in color. So bila enzyme tu dah habis buat kerja dia with the presence of oxygen, kita nampak the part that is exposed yang sudah dikerjakan oleh enzyme tu dah bertukar warna lah macam tu. So for this particular question, the apples, the exposed part of the apple are two parts, part E and part F. In part part E dengan F, ya, saya tulis X dengan Y pula, sorry ya. Part E is soaked in alkaline, part F is soaked in distilled water. Part E direndam dalam larutan alkali, part F direndam dalam air suling. So explain your observation. Okay, explain your observation. Let's see here. Rosham Haikal, are you okay? Boleh ke? Boleh access kepada padat dan jawab dekat padat ke? Sebab dekat dashboard saya ni tak ada indication apa you are here. Boleh ya? Alright, alright. Okay. Sebab selalu kalau ada student sedang menaik, dia akan keluar titik, 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 titik. So I know that you are in the process of answering. So let's take a look. Now, I agree with most of your answers. You started off with the observation. Kamu bagi tahu dulu observation apa yang kamu nampak. Part E jadi apa? Part F jadi apa? So part E, no change, but part F turns brown atau turns black. Saya terima jawapan turns black sebab yalah, gambar kita kan gambar hitam putih kan. Turns grey pun saya terima sebab you are answering based on the diagram. Good, saya bersetuju. Okay, that is the observation. Okay, so that is point number one. Okay, markah dia tiga kan? That is point number one. Point number one, kita bagi tahu apa yang kita nampak. Bahagian E remains the same atau no change. Bahagian F has turned brown, has turned black, has become darker, has become grey. Either of any one of the answer, any one of the observation. Okay, itu point one. Point two, okay, kena cerita lebih lagi, more than just saying part E is soaked in alkaline. Apa yang alkaline tu buat terhadap tindak balas enzyme? We have to explain more than just saying part E is soaked in alkaline, part F is soaked in distilled water. Why? Sebab dalam soalan dia dah cakap. So kalau kita sebut dalam kita punya jawapan, itu dikira mengulang soalan. Tak ada perkembangan daripada soalan tersebut. So apa yang alkaline buat? Okay, apa yang alkaline condition buat? Atau apakah alkaline condition tu apa kepada tindak balas enzyme? Can enzyme work in alkaline condition? Okay, that is the explanation. Okay, because alkaline condition adalah apa terhadap the reaction of enzyme. Yes, okay, saya setuju dengan idea Sarah. Okay, Sarah dia highlight highlight the effect of alkaline condition that will denature the enzyme in part E. Okay, very good. So dalam daripada jawapan Sarah ni, first part observation dia dah dapat. Dia kata part F turn brown, part E does not turn brown. Part yang kedua dia sebut pasal high in pH value. Point number two. Point number three, causing the enzyme to become denatured. Okay, bila enzyme dah denatured, ada lagi benda yang kita boleh tulis, kita boleh kembangkan lagi. Bila kita tahu enzyme has denatured, ada lagi yang kita boleh explain. Enzyme yang denatured tu active site dia macam mana? For example kan? So active side dia macam mana? So apakah kesan dia kepada formation of enzyme substrate complex ke? Macam itulah. Apa proses yang tidak berlaku ke? Kan? Okay, bila dah denatured, apa yang berubah lagi? And then, apa proses yang tidak boleh berlaku? Kan? Okay. So, yang Sarah tulis tu dah dapat dah 3 markah. Bila Sarah berhenti sampai denatured tu, okay, yes, very good. Okay, tambahan lagi. Denatured enzyme causes no enzyme substrate complex to form. Good. Okay, tak ada enzymes. Change the structural or the structure of active site. Macam Atira cadangkan. Okay, good. Betul. Bila dah denatured, the structure of active site sudah berubah. Good. Okay, so tak bolehlah buat enzyme substrate complex, good. And then, tak boleh buat proses apa? Okay, ini memang bonus lah. Tak boleh buat proses apa? Bila tukar jadi warna brown tu, sebenarnya itu adalah proses apa? Start dengan huruf U. Okay, start dengan huruf U. Tapi basically kamu dah dapat 3 markah ya. Nisa dah dapat 3 markah, Sarah dah dapat 3, Atira dah dapat 3, Najwa sikit lagi. Okay, okay, dia ada, at least dah dapat 2 markah kat situ. Okay, Widat pun dah dapat 3, very good. Okay, apa dia lepas tu? Start dengan huruf O. Proses apa yang tak dibuat kat situ? Kalau nak tambah lagi lah. Okay. Okay, so kita cuba lagi sekali. Saya highlight kat sini beberapa sample answer. Alright. Okay, so this is one of the sample answer. Okay, ini jawapan daripada Nisa. Okay, so this Nisa start dengan apple does not turn brown dekat bahagian E, on part E. Okay, because it has been soaked in alkaline solution. Okay, so in alkaline solution tak dapat markah lagi. Tapi sebab dia sebut has high pH value, boleh dapat markah. Sebab dalam soalan dia hanya sebut alkaline, dia tak sebut pH value dia berapa. So high pH value, good, point number two. That causes the enzyme to become denatured, point number three. Point number four, changes active site of the enzyme. Okay, changes the active site of the enzyme is point number four. Okay. Alright, and then okay, changes. So, bila kejap. Okay, so, satu lagi ialah bila changes the shape of active site, kita boleh tutup jawapan kita dengan cadangan daripada Sarah, iaitu no enzyme substrate complex can be formed. Itu point number five. Point number six, no oxidation can occur in part E. Tak ada proses pengoksidaan berlaku pada bahagian E. Nama proses yang jadi browning ni, yang tukar jadi brown ni ialah oxidation. Okay, oxidation. Tak apa. Memang istilah oxidation tu kita akan start guna bila kita dah belajar topik form 5 sebenarnya. So, when you revisit this question, you will remember, kamu akan rasa macam, oh okay, oxidation kita boleh guna kat sini. Sebab kamu belum belajar satu topik tu, so it's okay if you don't mention it, because you already got maximum three marks. Okay, I give you one more minute to update your answer. Okay, make sure all of you update your answer sebab nanti bila nota ni sampai dekat kamu punya email, kalau kamu tak jawab, dia akan jadi dia jadi nota kosong, tak ada jawapan. So you need to write in your answer so that you can, when you refer to the answer after this, when you refer to the notes after this, you have the answer already. So another 25 second. Hari ni kita go slow sikit sebab kita ada kawan yang baru berjinak-jinak dengan platform ni. Right. Okay Najwa. A good observation Najwa. Okay, good explanation. You got point one already. Oh, sorry. Saya unlock. Point one. Point two, enzyme denature sudah. Oxidation cannot occur. Good. Okay, cukup. Dapat full mark. Najwa, very good. Okay, now the next part is a sort of K-BUT question because you have to suggest. So can you suggest and explain another treatment to avoid sliced apple from turning brown? Tadi kita tahu dia turn brown sebab oxidation process conducted by enzyme. So selain daripada kita soak in alkaline, what are other suggestions that you can come up with that can avoid slice apple from turning brown? Okay, so kita tahu punca-punca dia tadi ialah sebab terdedah dengan oksigen. So ada cara tak untuk mengelakkan daripada surface tu terdedah dengan oksigen? Atau ada cara tak untuk kita menghentikan tindak balas enzim? Okay. Okay, I can see your suggestions already. So it is 3 marks question. So your suggestion and explanation why your treatment will work. Kenapa kamu punya treatment tu akan berkesan menghalang daripada oxidation? Why your suggestion will work? What is the process that occur when we do as you suggested? Okay, I can see your answer here. Okay, just now we can see that we treated the apple with alkaline solution. So ada yang bagi idea, okay, kita letaklah pula dalam acidic solution. Betul juga. Okay, that for that suggestion you get 1 point. Very good. So if you soak in acidic solution, dia punya explanation dia apa? Very good. Okay, so Rahil punya idea ialah slow down the enzymatic reaction. Good. Okay, good. Betul. Saya setuju. It can slow down the low pH condition, can slow down the enzymatic reaction. Okay, itu poin yang kedua Rahil. Poin yang ketiga, Rahil boleh tambah. Kita boleh sort of recycle balik point yang kita guna untuk alkaline tadi. pH tu, the pH provided by lemon juice tu is what towards the reaction of enzyme. Is it suitable? Is it optimal or not suitable for the reaction of enzyme? Okay, itu untuk orang yang jawab acidic condition lah. Basically, you want to say acidic condition kan. Low pH ya, acid adalah low pH kan. Okay. Okay, so ada yang bagi cadangan dekat sini. Macam cadangan dia ialah lebih kurang macam nak kata ala-ala osmosis pun ada. Sebab sebab rendam dalam air garam, soak in salt water. Okay, saya setuju dengan idea soak in salt water ni. Tapi dia punya explanation tu, mungkin kamu punya explanation tu kamu ambil daripada subtopik osmosis, I think. Sebab dia, some, idea kamu ni macam idea orang nak buat jeruk buah. Kita rendam dalam concentrated salt solution atau concentrated sugar solution. Water from the fruit will diffuse out. Therefore, there is no water that will enable atau facilitate the biochemical reaction of enzyme. Okay, so if you want to say your method is soaking in concentrated solution, so kamu punya explanation lebih kurang macam nak cerita pasal osmosis lah, right? So you are stopping the reaction of enzyme because you remove water from the cells of the fruit atau cells of the apple. Okay, so sama juga ya. Kalau saya tengok ada satu lagi jawapan kat sini, dia pun kata rendam dalam salt water solution, you got 1 out of 3 marks. So when you put sliced apple in a concentrated salt water solution, water will diffuse out. Point number 3, there is no water that can facilitate biochemical reaction atau there is no water to enable enzyme to do reaction. Okay, itu kaedah yang kedua. Okay, saya nak tengok kok ada kaedah lain ya. Letak dalam acid, letak dalam salt water, letak dalam lemon juice. Okay. Antara kaedah lain juga ialah kita soak atau rendam apple dalam air panas. Soak the apple in hot water. Why? Because hot water akan membuatkan enzyme jadi apa? Enzyme akan jadi high temperature. Ini yang kita discuss hari Isnin hari itu. Soaking the apple in high temperature environment atau in hot water causes the enzyme to become denatured. Okay, so that no oxidation process can occur. Last kali ialah ini adalah idea untuk instead kita tahu bila ada oksigen, baru enzyme tu akan tindak balas kan. So, suggestion seterusnya ialah suggestion yang berkaitan dengan preventing oksigen to come in contact with the surface of the apple. Kita buat langkah menghalang oksigen dissolve atau diffuse dalam pada permukaan apple yang terdedah. Iaitu kita salutlah permukaan apple yang terdedah tu dengan gula atau minyak. Okay. Kita salut, kita lumur the surface of the fruit atau surface of the apple with oil. So bila kita coat surface with oil, the enzymes will not be exposed to the oxygen in the air. enzim tidak terdedah kepada oksigen di persekitaran, maka proses pengoksidaan tidak berlaku. So, suggestion, explanation, apa yang suggestion kamu buat, kamu tutup dengan therefore no oxidation process can occur. Kamu bagilah suggestion apa pun, last kali matlamat dia ialah no oxidation process will occur, kan? So it, that can be your final point, point three. Okay. Najwa dengan Rosham okay ke? Boleh follow ke? Am I too fast for you? Boleh terus type dekat kamu punya padlet tu ya. Saya boleh baca terus kat situ. Am I too fast? Kalau too fast bagi tahu ya. Stop me. Okay, you may stop me. Okay. Saya akan screenshot a few sample answer. Okay, this one is for concentrated solution. And another one is acidic solution. Alright. So saya lampirkan juga dalam Telegram so that you may refer to it later. Okay. Alright. Okay, dah tak ada siapa menaik. I assume that all of you have update your answer. Okay, last kali untuk soalan berkaitan dengan chapter 5 ni ya. This one. This is application of enzyme in daily life. Now we know that some detergents macam Biozip have enzyme inside it. So suggest how to use the detergent to get maximum result. Suggest how ni markah dia tiga, maknanya basically kena nyatakan tiga suggestion lah. Kita tahu dalam detergent ni ada enzyme. So macam apa yang kita boleh sediakan semasa kita cuci baju guna detergent ni supaya tindak balas enzyme tu maksimum. Apa yang kita boleh adjust atau ubah suai atau gunakan atau set semasa kita basuh baju guna bio detergent. Okay, good. I can see some of you are already on the right track. So, ingat kembali factors affecting atau influencing enzyme. Antara faktor dia ialah temperature, pH, enzyme concentration and substrate concentration. Kan? So, what are the conditions most optimum for the reaction of enzyme inside a detergent? Enzyme dia suka suhu berapa? Okay, good. Use optimum temperature around 37 to 40 degrees Celsius. Maknanya basically kita guna air suam lah untuk membasuh. Bukan cold water, air suam. So cold water tu is for very delicate materials macam silk dan sebagainya. So selain daripada faktor suhu, okay, selain daripada faktor suhu, we can also say what type of enzyme suitable to be inside detergent? Apa contoh enzyme yang kita boleh buat gunakan kat sini? What type of enzyme that can that is suitable inside the detergent? Kita guna enzyme jenis apa? Can you think of one enzyme yang sesuai? Okay, and then selalunya bila kita basuh baju yang sangat kotor, kita apa tu, macam iklan Dynamo kan, kita sapu sedikit pada kotoran dan tuang bakinya ke dalam cucian. Lepas tu biasanya kita buat apa? Kita tak terus cuci, kita buat apa? Okay, that is another idea, ya. Oh, I see. Okay. Oh, I see. Okay, okay. Now, some of you, since you see that the mark is 3 marks, so dia nyatakan suggestion and then dia bagi explanation kan. So soalan ni, okay, soalan ni tak perlu explain suggestion sebab dia kata suggest how. Oh, kejap. Sebab dia kata suggest how, ya. Okeylah, boleh lah. Okey, boleh. So, okey. Kalau nak explain suggestion tu boleh terima, ya, sebab dia kata suggest how. So, nombor satu, use warm water, temperature between 37 to 40 degrees Celsius, nombor satu. Nombor dua, because the temperature is optimum temperature for the reaction of enzyme. Number three, therefore, maximum rate of reaction between enzyme and stains occur, kan? Maximum rate of reaction between enzyme and stains can occur. Okay. Increases the frequency of effective collision tu pun betul, ya. Tak ada masalah, Nisa. Boleh teruskan. Betul tu. Itu enzyme and stain, kan? Kita nak enzyme tu bertindak balas dengan kotoran, musnahkan kotoran degil. Okay. Selain daripada itu, yeah, besides that, okay, besides using warm water, kita juga boleh suggest untuk kita rendam dulu cucian tersebut at least for 5 minit. Bagilah duration yang munasabah. 5 minutes ke, 10 minutes ke. Kita rendam dulu dalam air panas to give time for enzyme to react with the stains. And then we can also suggest what type of protein. Kita juga boleh cadangkan protein apa yang sesuai kat sini. Dalam soalan, dia tak kata, dia hanya kata detergent tu ada enzyme. Tapi kita boleh suggest enzyme apa yang most probably ada dalam detergent tersebut. What do you think? Yeah. So Roshan boleh update kamu punya jawapan. Okay, you can update your answer by explaining further. Warm water tu adalah optimum temperature. Kalau kita sebut optimum temperature tu, dah dapat poin yang kedua. Optimum temperature for reaction of enzyme. Okay. Enzyme yang kita boleh guna ialah, okay, bagus. Atira, dia dah ada idea tu guna protein stain, kan? So kalau protein stain untuk dissolve atau remove protein stain, so dia punya enzyme dia apa? Okay, bagus idea tu, protein stain. So enzyme dia adalah protease. Yes, very good, Rahil. Okay, enzyme dia adalah protease. Ha. Okay, sekejap, ya. Bukan minimum, ya. Optimum temperature dia optimum temperature. Kita tengok eh. Okay, baru dapat markah kedua kat situ because it is the optimum temperature for maximum rate of enzyme reaction. Tambah sikit kat situ, for maximum rate of enzyme reaction. Enzyme reaction tu dalam konteks mencuci baju, enzyme tu guna untuk apa? To remove stains. Okay, to remove stains. Okay, please refer to my feedback. Dan kita boleh juga kata enzyme yang boleh sesuai ada kat situ ialah enzyme amylase, protease and also lipase. Kenapa lipase? Sebab lipase tu boleh dissolve lipid base stain macam minyak. Kan? Minyak kan basically triglyceride lipid. So bolehlah dicernakan atau breakdown by lipase. Okay, saya tunggu tiga orang ni yang tengah menulis. Sekejap ya, saya tukar kepada student base dulu. Okay, teruskan menulis, tak ada masalah. Saya akan pergi ke slide yang kita nak discuss hari ni, iaitu cell division. Okay, cell division. So, we know that for cell division, tolong pergi ke slide ketujuh ya. Go to slide 7 please. Untuk orang yang dah habis menyalin, go to slide 7. Okay, go to slide 7. So we know that in cell division, we learn about the process of mitosis and meiosis. For this particular question, this diagram shows phases of mitosis. So can you arrange the phase in correct sequence? Ada nombor kat bawah tu, kat tepi tu, 1, 2, 3, 4. Antara P, Q, R dengan S tu, siapa nombor 1, siapa nombor 2, siapa nombor 3, siapa nombor 4. Oh, semua orang dah habis salinnya. Alright, thank you. So boleh pergi ke, sorry. This one, okay. Boleh pergi ke slide ni. Alright, ni sajalah apa, macam biasalah bila soalan-soalan macam ni, kita label turutan dulu, kita state the name dulu, kita state the name of the structure, state the name of process, memang biasalah tu. Okay, siapa yang belum bergerak lagi ni? Okay, nombor 4 tu dah bergerak. Alright, very good. The first one is R, second one is Q, third one is S and finally the fourth is P. Okay, R, Q, S, P. Very good. Okay. Oh, sorry. Alia boleh, kalau Alia kalau pakai komputer, you have to click and drag. Ya. Click and drag. Okay. Nampak Alia pun tak bergerak lagi. Okay, dah bergerak. Good. Okay, sekarang kita dah identify which phases is number 1, 2, 3 and 4. Let's take a look at the next question. Yeah, let's take a look at the next question. Okay, this question is a 2-level question. Mula-mula bagi nama dulu. Phase Q is what? Phase S is what? And then you have to describe or state what is the activity of chromosome during phase Q and during phase S. So basically kena ada 4 point kat sini lah. Nama, chromosomal behavior, nama dan chromosomal behavior. Right.
Okay, let's take a look at your answer. Bagus. Dia dah kenal dah. Memang senang nak kenal face Q ni. Okay, good. Face Q is metaphase. Okay, teruskan. What is the chromosomal behavior during metaphase? Chromosome buat apa kat situ? What is the verb that we use to explain chromosome behavior? Kita guna kata kerja apa? Dia tengah berlari ke, tengah berjalan ke, berenang ke, kan? Yes, very good. Okay. Phase Q. Phase Q kat situ. Saya bersetuju. Phase Q is metaphase. Chromosome align in single row at the equatorial plane. Okay, itu versi canggih. Kalau kamu tulis chromosome line up at the center of the cell pun betul. Okay, center of the cell tu ialah equatorial plane tu, tengah-tengah cell lah. Okay, if you don't remember the term equatorial plane, it is okay, but we can see the chromosomes are at the center of the cell. So kita terima ya. So cukup dua markah untuk phase Q. Chromosome align at the cell equator. Chromosome align at the equatorial plane atau at the cell equator atau at the center of the cell. Cukup. Okay, good. Okay, fasa S tu pula apa? Fasa S tu pula apa? Okay. So, ingat balik. Dia punya tertib ialah prophase, metaphase, anaphase and telophase. Prophase, metaphase, anaphase and telophase. So Q is the second one, which is metaphase. S is the third one. So it is apakah ia? Anaphase. Yes. Okay. Saya setuju dengan Najwa. Najwa pun tulis, dah tulis dah tu anaphase. Nisa pun dengan Widat pun dah tulis anaphase. Very good. Alright. Yes. Yes, I can see your answer Najwa. Very good. Okay. Untuk S, Najwa kata sister chromatids become separated and pulled to the opposite side of the cells. Yes, very good, very complete. Thank you. Okay. Good, thank you, thank you. Okay. Okay, if you want to mention divided at the centromere into two sister chromatids. Sekejap, saya tengok jawapan dulu. Divided at the centromere into two sister chromatids. Tukar sikit. Divided at the centromere into two chromatid. Bukan two sister chromatid, two chromatid. Setiap satu sister chromatid tu, okay, so you are using chromosome kan? So kalau kita nak cakap betul-betul, sebenarnya semasa metaphase, the ones that line up at the equatorial planes are sister kromatik. Ha, kalau kita tak nak guna kromosom, sebenarnya yang beratur di tengah-tengah sel tu ialah sister kromatik. During anaphase, okay, semasa anaphase, the centromere that holds the sister chromatid together fully divided, cause producing two chromatids. Ah, okay, bagus. Dia terus betulkan. Syabas. Okay, betul. Memang during anaphase, the centromere has fully divided. Has fully divided. So that the chromatids that form sister chromatids can be separated. Very good. Okay, and then lagi tapi yang paling obvious dekat gambar tu, dia memang dah, kita nampak kromatik tu dah berpisah kan? Dia dah jauh antara satu sama lain. Ha, dah jauh dah. So spin dia dah jauh sebab kromosom, kenapa kromosom is like that during phase S? Because spindle fiber become shorter, thus pulling the sister chromatid into separate poles of the cell. Opposite poles of the cell, yes. Okay, yeah. Alright, very good. Okay, very good. Wow, your verb is very good, Rasha. Chromosome segregate to opposite poles of the cell. Betul. I agree with you. Sister chromatid pull apart at the opposite poles of the cell. Saya setuju, Rahil. Very good. Alia? Yes, Alia juga very good. Okay, dia sama macam Sarah. Dia cerita pasal centromere yang fully divided. But if you look at the picture, okay, if you look at the picture, the most accurate description that we can use, kalau kita kena pilih lah antara describing centromere fully separated dengan sister chromatid move to opposite poles, gambar S tu lebih menggambarkan sister chromatid pull to the opposite poles of the cell. Itu lebih tepat lah for that particular diagram. Okay, thank you so much, everyone already answered. Now let's take a look at the next question. Ni senang saja, bagi tahu nombor. Based on the diagram, how many chromosomes do you see? How many chromosomes do you see? Hanya tulis nombor saja, tak payah type ya. Tulis nombor. Oh, I do like this. Okay. How many chromosome? Cuba kira ada berapa yang panjang, berapa yang pendek. Okay, so semua pun jawab tiga semua pun jawab tiga. Okay, mari kita tengok gambar tu balik. Haa, mari kita tengok gambar balik. Cuba kira satu persatu. Saya kira dekat situ yang panjang ada dua. Satu panjang putih, satu panjang hitam. Dah dua dah kat situ. Yang sederhana panjang ada dua. Satu warna hitam, satu warna putih. Yang pendek juga ada dua. Satu hitam, satu putih. So ada berapa kat situ? Ceng, ceng, ceng. Ada berapa? Ada enam. Yes. Dia dah nampak dia terus tukar. Bagus. Syabas. Okay, enam tu betul. Okay, enam tu betul. Alright. So dia terus tukar. Jawapan dia 6 ya. Kita tengok satu-satu. Saya faham kenapa kamu kata 3. Sebab kamu membayangkan membayangkan mungkin mereka ni adalah sister chromatic ke? Saya pun tak sure. Mungkin kamu bayangkan dia sister chromatic kot. Tapi ingat, bila sister chromatic, dia mestilah sama warna. Lepas tu dia attach kat tengah-tengah, melekat kat tengah-tengah. Kromosom yang ada dekat dalam gambar ni, dia tak attach, warna tak sama dan dia tak attach pada sentromere. So setiap satu kromosom yang ada kat situ, kita nampak ada 3 hitam dan 3 putih. So 3 hitam, 3 putih, total dia 6. Okay, right. Now, kita nak lukis pula. So saya copy paste gambar tadi semula untuk rujukan. So the same cell in diagram 3.1 undergo mitosis, can undergo meiosis. Okay, kalau cell dalam diagram 3.1 tu undergo mitosis, can you draw one daughter cell of apa cell dalam diagram 3.1? Kalau dia undergo meiosis, boleh tak lukis satu product atau satu daughter cell at the end of meiosis for cell in diagram 3.1? Okay. Kalau diagram 3.1 ni undergo mitosis, last kali daughter cell dia rupa macam mana? Kalau itu peta atas. Lukis dekat peta atas. Kalau diagram 3.1 tu undergo meiosis, last kali daughter cell tu rupa dia macam mana? Lukis dekat peta bawah. Okay. So I can understand if you if you are struggling to draw. So pelan-pelan ambil masa depa Sarah Rahil, Atira, Nisa dengan Widat Rahil dengan Sarah ni dia memang dah expert dah. Lukis-lukis ni. Lukis satu je sayang. Lukis satu sel je. So lukis satu bulat je ya, tak boleh lukis banyak-banyak. Lukis satu saja, one daughter cell only. Oh rajin dia nak lukis dua daughter cell dia. Okay, sabar ya, pelan-pelan lukis. I understand it's not easy for you ya, memang tak senang. Okay, so untuk untuk yang baru guna padded ni, for me it is easier for you to use the pencil function and then draw lah. Okay, lepas tu bila nak lukis kromosom ni nanti, just ambil pencil punya function ni dan tebalkan sikit. So bolehlah buat satu yang panjang, lepas tu buatlah satu yang pendek dan sebagainya lah. Tebalkan saja, senang. Okay, tebalkan saja. That is the easiest way to draw lah. Wow, saya nampak ada yang lukis nucleus lah. Oh, I'm so proud of you. You draw nucleus. Good, good, good. Teruskan, teruskan. Tapi ingat ya, anak-anak, asalnya tadi nucleus dia ada nucleus pula. Dalam diagram 3.1, asal sel tu ada 6 kromosom. So based on our discussion about mitosis, kan ke fungsi mitosis tu adalah to maintain the genetic composition of the cell? to produce a cell that is exactly the same as the parent cell, diagram 3.12 adalah parent cell dia. So bila parent cell undergo mitosis, kan ke mitosis tu fungsi dia ialah untuk menghasilkan satu exact copy of the parent cell. Exact copy of the parent cell. Okay. So maknanya tu biasa saya sebut exact copy of the parent cell. So if the parent cell have 6 chromosomes, how many chromosomes do you think does a daughter cell have after mitosis? Kalau parent cell dalam diagram 3.12 mengalami mitosis, kan ke mitosis tu fungsi dia ialah untuk mengekalkan maklumat genetik, menghasilkan sel yang sama sebiji macam parent cell atau sel asal. So sel asal ada 6 kromosom, jadi sel anak atau daughter cell after mitosis, berapa bilangan kromosom dia? Sama ke tak sama? Okay. Terbanyak pula membebel malam ni ya. Sorry. Yes, very good. I can see some of you already got it. Good. Here are a few example ya. Ingat kalau kromosom dia ada 6, so at the end of mitosis, the number of chromosomes are maintained. Okay. Now, these two are good examples. Okay, these two are good examples. Mitosis, untuk mitosis dia betul, tak ada masalah. Okay, for this one, okay, untuk yang ni, dia lukis bilangan kromosom dia cukup, ada 6. Tapi semuanya hitam. So, dah tak sama dengan parent cell. Parent cell kan ada 3 yang putih kan. So you have to redraw 3 of the chromosome ya. You have to redraw 3 of the chromosome into white color. Okay.
Excuse me teacher.
Ya.
Screen stuck. Dia macam tak tunjuk.
Sorry. Sorry, saya bersalah, minta maaf. Okay, sekarang saya tunjuk. Okay, sampel yang saya tunjuk kat sini in terms of number of chromosomes tu, okay, betul. Tapi the color of the chromosomes tu tak betul ya. Kena betulkan sikit. Ada 3 yang warna putih. So, dia kena betulkan 3 lah. Okay, you have to redraw 3 chromosomes into white color. Okay, use white color. Okay, saya dah bagi personal feedback. Hopefully you can check it out. Okay, 2 example yang saya kata good example tadi are these two. Okay, these two. Ada ke tak? 1, 2, 3. And this one also. Okay, these two from Halis, Najwa and Sarah. Okay, untuk mitosis ya. Mitosis tu tak apa. Take your time. Pukis dulu. Okay, so we can see there are 3 black chromosomes, 3 white chromosomes, all at different length. Ada yang paling panjang, sederhana panjang dan paling pendek. Very good. Good job girls. Bagus. Okay, teruskan. Saya suka idea Atira ni ya. Atira dia buat warna. Atira dengan Nisa dia teringat kenangan kita belajar masa hari tu ya. So dia guna warna biru dengan merah. So untuk hari ni tak apa, saya faham. But for nanti masa exam nanti, make sure you maintain the same color ya. Okay, make sure you maintain the same color. Tiga hitam, tiga putih. Tapi hari ni saya maafkanlah sebab I can see you have three blue and three red. Okay, tak ada masalah. Saya assume three tu adalah representing black, three tu representing white. So, yang untuk this one tadi, kena make sure another three is a different color. Alright. Let's take a look at meiosis pula. Saya tengah tunggu meiosis punya gambar. Okay. So quite a few of you have already finished meiosis punya gambar. Okay. So it is okay for you to draw nak kata apa ya, to draw product of meiosis ni kalau tak ada, nak kata apa ya, kalau tak ada dot color lain ni, macam Sarah buat ni warna putih, hujung dia ada dot hitam. Kalau tak ada dot pun tak apa. If you don't indicate crossing over has occurred pun tak apa, tak ada masalah. It's still correct. Yang saya cari untuk gambar meiosis ialah the number of chromosome is 3. Okay, the number of chromosome is 3, indication yang pertama. Indication yang kedua, saya akan lihat tiga kromosom yang ada dalam sel tersebut, panjang dia berbeza. Satu sangat panjang, satu sederhana panjang, satu paling pendek. Okay, yang macam I like your idea, Rosham. Rosham dia guna color yang, kejap ya, kejap, clear the stars back. Okay, alright, this one. Okay, dia Rosham dia guna color yang macam cream sikit. So okay lah, bagus lah, senang juga nak indicate that is the, that you are using it to representing the white chromosome. Bagus. Okay, so lukisan Rosham ni adalah tepat, betul. I can see in meiosis you have three chromosomes. Betul, sebab at the end of meiosis, the number of chromosome is half. Bagus. Sikit je nak kena tweak sikit, boleh tak kamu bagi salah satu kromosom tu paling panjang? Itu je. Sebab nak bagi nampak satu sangat panjang, sederhana dengan pendek. Sebab saya tak nampak beza dua yang panjang tu. So saya nak minta tolong Rosha, boleh tak tolong tambah kepanjangan mana-mana satu kromosom, tambah. Ada dua yang panjang dekat meiosis tu kan, tolong panjangkan lagi salah satu tu supaya nampak lebih tepat. Yang tu okey dah sebenarnya, tapi nak nampak lebih tepat ya. Alright, good job. Okay, sikit lagi. Oh, yang tak siap lukis tu Nadrah rupanya. Okay, that is my slide punya. Okay, so saya present balik a few good sample answer ya. Dan saya screenshot. Oh, Rahil dia guna warna biru. Okay, I understand your drawing. Very good. So, saya screenshot dulu drawing, both drawings ni. And then I will put it in the Telegram for you to refer later. Sebab nanti kan petak ni dia akan hantar email nota. So, you can refer to the Telegram for the answers later. Okay. So anak-anak, this is how we assess, this is how, Allah Akbar, this is how the examiners assess whether you remember and can apply the process of mitosis and meiosis. The principles of mitosis is, the objective of mitosis is to produce a new cell that is exactly the same as the parent cell. Sebab itulah kita lukis. Sebab itulah kita lukis the number of chromosome is exactly the same as the parent cell. Whereas in meiosis, the intention of meiosis is to produce a cell that has half number of chromosome compared to the parent cell. So parent cell tadi ada 6 chromosome. Now at the end of meiosis, the daughter cell only have 3 chromosome. Macam ni selalu kes ni. Very good. Okay anak-anak. Now let's take a look at the next question. Next question is explaining our answer. Can you explain why you draw mitosis have 6 chromosome and meiosis has 3 chromosome? Can you explain why? Okay. Okay, good. Okay, when you mention that the aim of meiosis, lebih kurang lah, that this is what I understand from ada 4 jawapan panjang kat sini. Matlamat meiosis is to produce daughter cell that has haploid number of chromosome from the parent cell. Good. Okay, that is one mark. Dekat situ dah dapat satu markah. Bila kamu cerita meiosis menghasilkan kromosom that contain haploid number of chromosome. Yes, it is acceptable sebab dalam soalan it does not indicate the number of chromosome. Dia hanya kata kenapa number of chromosome dia berbeza kan. Tapi dia tak cakap pun siapa separuh, siapa haploid, siapa diploid. So in our answer we say during meiosis, because of meiosis, the number of chromosome has become haploid. Okay, that is point number one. Point number two, since you are on the track of explaining, kamu dalam laluan, you are on the right track to explain meiosis, explain further. Masa bila dalam meiosis, the number of chromosome started to become haploid? Semasa prophase 1 ke, metaphase 1 ke, anaphase 1 ke, telophase 1 ke, prophase 2 ke, metaphase 2 ke, anaphase 2 ke, telophase 2? In which stage does this process occur? Okay, saya nampak ada seorang lagi, ada seorang kawan kita, dia compare, dia sebut, dia nak cerita jawapan dia dalam konteks mitosis. Betul juga. So you can say the aim of mitosis is to produce an identical cell atau to produce a new identical cell atau to produce a new cell identical to the parent atau a new cell that maintains the same genetic information. Boleh. That is point one. So macam mana nak cerita explanation kalau kita nak explain mitosis kan? Ha, okay. Kalau kita nak explain mitosis, okay, kalau kita nak explain mitosis, kejap ya. Okay, saya nak tengok. Sebab saya perasan macam macam Nisa. Sebab ayat kedua Nisa tu cerita pasal mitosis kan? So saya jadi inspired nak explain pasal reasoning for mitosis. Kejap ya. Okay. Okay. So saya repeat balik sebab ada yang macam saya nampak dia taip, metu padam sebab dia macam nak cerita pasal meiosis. So saya cerita pasal meiosis dulu. Okay. The explanation can be in three ways. Okay, three ways. Number one, kita cakap pasal the aim of meiosis is to produce a cell that has haploid number of chromosome. Tujuan meiosis adalah menghasilkan sel yang mempunyai bilangan kromosom yang haploid. Okay, kemudian poin yang kedua kita cerita pada fasa atau pada peringkat mana bilangan kromosom tu jadi separuh. Cuba ingat balik. Dari prophase 1 sampailah telophase 2, masa bila bilangan kromosom sudah jadi separuh. Okey, itu adalah task untuk mereka yang memilih untuk explain meiosis. Untuk mereka yang explain mitosis, okey, macam Nisa dia dah salin ayat saya tadi, the aim of mitosis is to produce cell that have diploid number of chromosome. And the daughter cells are identical to the parent cell. Okay Nisa, bagus. So kita nak explain untuk mitosis pula. Untuk mitosis, dari prophase, metaphase, anaphase dengan telophase, which stage that ensures the division of chromosome is equal to each side. To opposite poles, therefore producing daughter cells that have equal number of chromosome. Saya repeat balik. Ingat balik fasa-fasa dalam mitosis, ada prophase, metaphase, anaphase dengan telophase. Antara empat-empat stage ni, yang mana satu yang bertanggungjawab untuk memastikan pembahagian yang sama rata, pembahagian kromosom yang sama rata to the opposite poles of the cells yang akhirnya menghasilkan sel bilangan kromosom dia kekal sama. Mana satu? Ha, itu tugas untuk orang yang jawab mitosis. Okay. Okay, I can see here from your answer. Okay, ada yang suggest telophase 2 eh. Ada orang suggest the telophase 2. Okay, telophase 2 dia membahagikan sel. Tapi yang mana satu yang membahagikan kromosom? Okay, ya. So, untuk mereka yang memilih untuk jawab explain meiosis, okay, this is a sample, a suggestion from me. Yeah? So, my suggestion is, we can say the chromosomes, the number of chromosomes started to become haploid during anaphase 1. Okay, during anaphase 1. Kejap. Saya ada gambar tak kat sini? I think I have. Ya, yeah, maaf ya. Saya pergi ke sini dulu. Nanti saya patah balik. Okay. Gambar yang saya tunjukkan dalam Google Meet sekarang dan dalam PDF sekarang ialah sebelah kiri meiosis 1 and sebelah kanan meiosis 2. Okey. Cuba tengok dekat meiosis 1 yang sebelah kiri, kamu nampak semasa metaphase 1 yang beratur, the ones that line it up at the equatorial plane, setiap satu baris spindle fiber tu ada sepasang sister chromatic atau homologous kromosom, ya, ada sepasang sister chromatic. So bila yang beratur dekat equatorial plane tu sepasang sister chromatic, dia beratur secara sepasang macam ni, menyebabkan bila spindle fiber tarik, dua akan pergi sebelah kiri, dua kromosom akan pergi sebelah kiri, dua kromosom akan pergi sebelah kanan. So, semasa anaphase 1, bilangan kromosom at the opposite poles of the cell has already become half. Siapa yang salah? Fasa apa yang bertanggungjawab yang menyebabkan bilangan kromosom jadi separuh? Anaphase 1. Because when anaphase 1 started, it pull half of the chromosome to the opposite poles of the cell. Kita tengok masa prophase 1 ada 4 kromosom. Kita tengok bila telophase 1 already satu side ada 2 kromosom, satu side lagi ada 2 kromosom. Daripada 4 kromosom dalam parent cell, sekarang sudah ada 2 saja kromosom dalam parent cell. Okay, so untuk menjawab mana tadi soalan ni tadi? Okay, untuk menjawab soalan ni tadi, itulah jawapan dia. During anaphase 1, homologous chromosomes are separated to the opposite pole. Okay, so anaphase 1 lah yang bertanggungjawab yang menyebabkan bilangan kromosom jadi separuh. Untuk mereka yang jawab pasal mitosis, untuk mereka yang memilih untuk jawab pasal mitosis, okey, semasa semasa anaphase, tadi kita cakap pasal anaphase 1. Tapi semasa anaphase untuk mitosis, siapa yang terpisah? Sister chromatic yang terpisah. Atau kromosom yang terpisah. Bukan homologous kromosom. Kromosom yang terpisah. Therefore, each pole will receive equal number of kromosom. Semasa mitosis, during anaphase, sister chromatid atau kromosom pull atau move to the opposite poles of the cell. This causes each pole, setiap bahagian, receive equal number of parent cell. Eh, anak-anak boleh follow ke ni? Saya cerita panjang ni boleh follow eh? Are you okay?
Boleh, teacher.
Boleh, boleh. Alright. Okay. And then untuk orang untuk mereka yang pilih nak explain meiosis, kita cerita bilangan kromosom jadi separuh pada anaphase 1. Why? Because during anaphase 1, the ones that line up at the equatorial plate is homologous chromosome. When anaphase 1 occurs, half of the chromosome move to the opposite poles of the cell. Okay, half of the chromosome move to the opposite poles of the cell. Okey anak-anak, sekarang ni dah 9.59. Saya pun tak nak buat soalan lain dulu. Saya simpan dulu revision pasal chapter 6 ni. Okey, sebab kita belum cerita pasal application dia lagi, ya, iaitu pasal apa ya? Pasal cancer cell dan sebagainya lah. Kita belum cerita lagi. So up until now, saya buat sedikit rumusannya. Up until now, what we have discussed today is first, we discuss about another factors that influencing the reaction of enzyme, which is pH. And then we also attempted to answer an application question about the use of enzyme in the detergent powder. So itu adalah contoh soalan kibat. Kamu dah cuba soalan kibat ya, tahniah. And then kita dah pergi kepada kita dah mula membincangkan mengenai mitosis and meiosis. We have attempted a question regarding mitosis and meiosis. Please be alert the number of chromosomes here. Bila kamu pun kalau dekat awal tadi kamu dah salah, kamu kata bilangan kromosom dia 3, nanti drawing ni pun salah. So nampak sini 1 markah, sini 4 markah. Bila silap dekat sini, dekat sini pun silap. Habis hilang 4-5 markah kat sini kan? Sayang saja. So please be more careful. Semoga bila ada pengalaman macam ni you can be more careful lah. Okay, so mistakes makes us better kan? Mistake makes us better. So sebagaimana biasa, saya akhiri dengan reflection of today. What did you like about today's activity, today's lesson? What didn't you like? Saya membebel banyak sangat ke? Saya laju sangat ke? Tulis kat situ. What was easy? Which question is easy for you that you like? Atau bila kamu reflect balik, apa yang kamu rasa macam semalam hari Isnin tu susah, hari ni dah jadi senang, for example. And then if you notice that there are things that you need for me to repeat or reteach, tulis under what was hard, okay? Okay, thank you so much for your responses. Tak suka draw ya? Okay, tak suka draw. It's a struggle, I understand. Okay, ada yang suka phases of mitosis? Dia tak tulis phases of meiosis ya, sebab lagi kompleks ya. Okay, elaborate the explanation. Okay, kita try lagi lah lepas ni. Questions about enzyme has become easier for you. Good. Okay, the last question ya. Last question is something that is very hard for you. Okay. I understand. Okay, I will address that tomorrow. Tomorrow ke? No, next week. Kan, next week. Next week kita punya kelas ya. Next week sebab tomorrow you got physics kan. Okay. Alright. Okay, thank you so much everyone for your understanding, your attention and your reflection. I will address your concerns. I will address your concerns during our next class, okay? Memang meiosis tu is fairly new, mitosis tu fairly new. So saya faham, I understand your predicament. Kita try our best to, I will try my best to repeat explain about the phases of meiosis and application of mitosis and meiosis, okay? So thank you so much for coming today. Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam teacher. Thank you.